Start recording. Good afternoon and welcome to the seminar optimization, one word seminar. It's my pleasure to introduce our speaker today, Robert Csetnek from the University of Vienna, from the next office. So Robert Csetnek received his diploma and his master in mathematics from the University of Cluj-Napoca, University of Cluj-Napoca, and then he moved to Chemnitz in Germany. He received his PhD in mathematics from Chemnitz University in 2009, and then he moved in 2013 to Vienna, and he defended his habilitation in 2016 the University of Vienna. So Robert is working on theoretical topics in optimization analysis, but also on numerical algorithms, on continuous time approaches. And his talk today will be on second order dynamical system with a particularity. But I guess that he will talk about some discrete aspects. So, Robert, we have 45 minutes for a talk.
Thank you. Thank you for the introduction. And I also want to thank the organizers for this invitation, of course. And hello, everybody, to my talk. As Rado already mentioned, so we last week in the OWOS seminar, we have seen a talk on accelerated methods in optimization on fast optimization methods. And my talk today is on a similar topic, but I want to approach now this from a different perspective, namely from the continuous perspective. So by this I mean considering some differential equations or differential equations attached to the problem we want to solve. So, and then to see also discretized versions of this continuous dynamics, and to see the interplay, of course, there is this the interplay between continuous dynamics and discretization. This talk is a joint work with Hedia Tush and Radu Bos. And this will be on second order dynamics with closed loop damping. So we will see a bit later what do we mean by closed loop, what are our results on this topic, and what are the challenges and the open questions in this context. I think I have the first problem. I cannot move to the next slide.
You should use the arrows. Yes. Okay.
Yeah. Now it's working. Okay. So let me start with an introduction and motivation. So suppose we want to solve an optimization problem of this form, where the objective f is convex and differentiable. And our setting is a real Hilbert space, and usually what we assume is that we have optimal solutions for our problem. Okay, so if we are in a convex setting. Now, if you want to approach this optimization problem by gradient systems, by numerical schemes of gradient flow, so which are first order differential equations, then it is known that the rate you can get is 1/t for the objective function along the trajectory or along the iterates. Yeah, so if you consider first order dynamics or iterations, numerical schemes, this is the best you can get in this setting, the rate 1/t. And if you want to obtain some fast optimization techniques, some fast optimization, fast numerical methods, then you have to pass to second order dynamics. So to consider also inertial methods, so involving a momentum. And As I mentioned, I want to approach today this by means of second order, by means of dynamical systems. And let me start with this second order dynamical system, which is which appears here, considered by Suboit-Kandes in 2014, and then later also by Ushkbani, Peipuke, and Redond. And of course, since then, the literature is very huge on this topic. So, what is important in this dynamics? So, like I said, we have a second order dynamic. This is not all we need here. For fast optimization methods, also the design of the damping is important. And namely, here we have the damping alpha over t, which is asymptotically vanishing damping. So when t converges to plus infinity, this approaches zero, alpha over t, but not too fast. And actually, this will be, this damping is the most important part in this dynamics, because with the help of this damping and by introducing, of course, some energy, Lyapunov functional, we are able, or the authors here proved these convergence rates. So, for example, in the case alpha greater than 3, for alpha greater than 3, we have this rate 1 over t square, and this is little o, 1 over t square, for this quantity, the objective function value along the trajectory minus the infimum of the function. Yes. In case alpha greater or equal than 3, we have actually a capital O, and for alpha greater than 3, we can improve this and namely to little o. So this is the fast convergence rate you can obtain here in this setting, and this is derived by investigating the properties of an energy of a Lyapunov functional in this context. What do you get further in this context? You can get also convergence of the trajectory, but of weak convergence, so in general weak convergence, but we have to be careful. We have again this this limiting case. The value of alpha has an influence here in the analysis, and namely for alpha greater than 3 you obtain convergence, weak convergence of the trajectory to a minimizer of the objective function. Now these are the main results. Okay. Of course, there is an intensive research on this topic. I mentioned here the two main results here about fast convergence rate, so the rate 1 over t square, and the weak convergence of the trajectory, in this case when alpha is greater than 3. Now, if you want to consider a discretization of this second order dynamic, you will, by means of some discretization technique, you will obtain this this numerical scheme, which appears here, which is in the spirit of the Nesterov accelerated scheme, a fast optimization method for smooth optimization problems, where you see you generate here two sequences, xk and yk. And this inertial term, so when you define the sequence yk, you add an inertial term. And again, this quantity which appears here in front of xk minus 1 has a special structure. I mean, in order to achieve this rate of 1 over k squared for Nesterov, of course, this has to have a special structure. So the inertial parameter in front of xk minus 1. This is only an illustration of what you have in the discrete case, namely that In order to define the next iterate xk plus 1, you use the previous two iterates xk and xk minus 1, naming that we have here inertial algorithms. But of course, this inertial parameter which appears here, 1 minus alpha over k. Of course, it is difficult to have a geometrical interpretation of the exact term, which is here 1 minus alpha over k. And actually, if we look in the analysis of this algorithm, then we will see why do we need this special structure for the scheme in order to achieve the Nesterov accelerated rate of order 1 over k squared. So let me pass further, namely considering dynamics with geometrical Hessian-driven damping. Namely, so what is new here is this term. Of course, we have now a C2 function in order to speak also about the Hessian, and now if we add this term here in our dynamics, this can have or may have some interesting consequences, which I want to list now, so to speak about. Namely, first of all, considering such a sequence, considering such a dynamical system, this will be related to Newton and Levenberg Marquardt iterative methods. We will see this again later on one of my slides. Why is this related also to Newton? May induce a stabilization of the trajectories. We have an example related to this. What happens if you consider discretization? So if you want to speak about numerical schemes, how to discretize this dynamical system, since you have here the Hessian and x dot? Well, if you consider this term, which is actually the time derivative of the gradient of f along the trajectory xt, then it becomes clear how to discretize when we speak about numerical schemes. Namely, you will have differences of this type, gradient fxk minus gradient fxk minus 1 in the numerical scheme. And let me point out here some recent advances related to algorithms where this difference appears in the fast optimization method, Shi, Du, Jordan, Su, but also Atushka, Bani, Fadili, and Riahi. And of course, there are also several other papers on this subject. Okay, so the most important thing, the fast convergence rate for the function value still remains. So by considering Hessian-driven damping, you still have the rate 1 over t squared. Of course, you have to be careful with alpha. In the damping, you have alpha over t, but for greater than 3, you have these convergence rates. And there is another aspect here. When considering second order dynamics with Hessian driven damping, then you obtain also fast decay of the gradient. Yeah, so you obtain also an improvement in the decay of the gradient. In comparison to the dynamics where you don't consider the Hessian-driven damping. And you obtain weak convergence of the trajectories for alpha greater than 3. So these are some benefits. So these are some benefits for considering second-order dynamics with viscous damping and Hessian-driven damping. And now I have here an illustration of the fact that the Hessian-driven damping may avoid oscillations in the behavior of the trajectories. This is an example of in two dimensions. So this function f, for which so right hand side, you have the second order dynamics without Hessian driven damping, and the left hand side with Hessian driven damping. And on this example, one can see that the Hessian-driven damping may avoid oscillations. Yes. Okay. So now I presented this Soviet Kandel second order dynamics, the second order dynamics with Hessian-driven damping. Now let me move to another dynamic. And let us see another link with the regularized Newton method, a link, namely, which I present in the following way. There is a contribution of Tuschenzweiter, which is this first order differential inclusion. Now, capital A, what is capital A? Capital A, maximal monotone operator. And the task is to solve to the zeros, the set of zeros of the maximum monotone operator A. Now, this first order differential inclusion is actually a continuous version of the Levenberg-Marquardt method, and is actually which is actually a regularization of the Newton method. To see this, if you consider the variational case, so if you consider the operator A to be the gradient of F, then you will end up with this first order dynamical system written here in blue, where you have now, and okay, of course we suppose that f is c2, we have here the Hessian driven, the Hessian of the function f, and then this will be this differential inclusion, in this case equation, in the case of a variational problem. And now this is indeed like a regularization of the Newton method, because you add this term here, sorry, you add the gamma t times identity, yes, in order to have in order to avoid the ill-posedness of the problem. But now this is a first order differential equation. And now if we look at this second order differential equation written now in red, this with viscous damping and Hessian driven damping, you can see this as an inertial or an accelerated method of this first order differential equation. Yes, so in blue we have a first order differential equation, and in red we have a second order accelerated method. So this is the link with the Levenberg-Marquardt method and the Newton method when we speak about second order dynamics with Hessian-driven damping. Now another contribution of Attusch, Redon, Zweiter, again starting with the maximal monotone operator A, is the investigation of this dynamical system which is of closed loop type. This is a first order differential inclusion with closed loop futures. Namely, if you consider again the variational case, so if you take again the operator A to be the gradient of F, so take A to be the gradient of F and replace here, then you will end up with this first order differential equation. Yes, and if you look here at the coefficient of x dot, so x dot is the velocity, you will see that we have here a damping which depends on the gradient of f along the trajectory. Yes, and this is what we call now a closed loop control of differential equation, namely the case when the damping depends on the trajectory itself. Yes. So this was Attusch-Redon-Zweiter, a first order differential equation, and of course it is a natural idea to consider also second order differential equations in the closed loop setting. Yes. So it makes sense to investigate second order dynamical systems with a damping gamma t, which may be also of closed loop type, yes, as motivated here by the approaches of Hattusch, Redon, Zweiter, for example. But however, we have also some recent contribution in the literature of Lean and Jordan, 2020, where they consider this second order dynamics, and again with closed loop damping. So the damping gamma T is again a closed loop type. Now, this dynamical system considered by Lean Jordan is a bit complicated, but if we look at the damping gamma T, so okay, what do we have? We have first here in the first equation in this system, we have lambda T. Lambda T depends on the gradient of F along the trajectory. Then you define AT in the second equation. And then in the third equation, you define the damping gamma T, which depends on A, on its derivative, and on its second derivative. And since in A, you already have the gradient of F along the trajectory XT, this means that indeed, this second order dynamics is a closed loop control system, meaning that the damping gamma T depends on the trajectory, actually on the gradient of F along the trajectory. And it is interesting to observe in this paper of Lean and Jordan that they get also some rates for the function values, and the rate depends on this coefficient, on this parameter P. So the parameter P appears, the parameter P appears in the first equation of the system. This is the parameter P, and the rate depends on this P. So this was about closed loop control systems, and actually Hattusch, Hedy Hattusch proposed us to investigate, to take a closer look, at closed loop control systems. Namely, the proposal of Hedy was to consider second order dynamics. So to investigate second order dynamics where the damping gamma T depends either on the trajectory or the on the gradient of the function along the trajectory or on the velocity x dot. So, and with the aim of getting some maybe some improved rates, maybe some fast optimization methods. Yes. And this is now the object, the topic of my talk. So I will speak about our results in this context, and also about challenges and open problems. So, okay, this slide is about open loop and closed loop strategies. The first one is open loop. So in the first part of the presentation, I have spoken about open loop strategies, so second order dynamics where the damping gamma T is given a priori as a time of function T. So this is alpha over T, and closed loop means now the damping gamma T, it's here in red, closed loop means that the damping depends on the trajectory x or on the gradient or on the velocity. So meaning that the damping is a feedback of the current state of the system. This is what we mean about closed loop. Okay, and our investigations are related. So we started, our starting point was this second order dynamics, where we consider phi. What is phi here is a convex damping potential. I will speak a bit later what do we mean by a convex damping potential. Subdifferential of phi is the convex subdifferential, and we call this autonomous damped inertial gradient equation. And v is coming from velocity. Namely, this is the damping depends on the velocity. So let me start with some particular cases and then present our results. So some particular cases. If you consider the damping phi, the damping potential phi to have this form, a quadratic form in U, then this will correspond to the heavy ball method. This is the heavy ball method here in blue. And this was introduced by Polyak And and then studied also by Atush Guduredont, Alvarez, Harujan Dubi, Begubolt, and Jendubi. Also investigated in the convex case, but also in the non-convex case under Kurdi-Kaliasilic properties. So in the heavy wall method, you see the damping, gamma is a constant damping, is a constant damping. So, and in this case, of course, you cannot expect fast optimization methods. Next case is the dry friction case. So when the damping potential phi has this form, norm U, then you will end up with this second order dynamics investigated, for example, by Adli Yatush and Cabot, but also Aman Diaz and again Adli Yatush. And this dynamical system is related to the finite time stabilization property of the trajectory. It's finite time stabilization. So if you want to have this property, then you have to use a dry friction effect in this form. And last, let me present also this particular case, phi, when this is norm of u to the power p, with p greater or equal than 1 in order to preserve the convexity of phi. And if you replace the convex subdifferential, then you will have this dynamical system where you see now the damping is damping depends on the velocity on x dot, norm of x dot to the power p minus 2. Yes, so this is the closed loop control where the damping depends on the velocity. And we will see that the power p which appears here has an influence here in the investigation we want to perform here. I will speak about weak damping and strong damping depending on the case when p is greater or greater than 2 or less than 2. Then in our paper, we consider also second order dynamics where the damping depends, where the damping is a combination of the velocity and of the gradient of f along the trajectory. and also with Hessian driven damping involved in the dynamics. You can consider again several particular cases. Let me take this quadratic case. So when phi, the damping potential, is the quadratic case, then you have second order dynamics investigated by Alvarez, Atush, Bolt, Redond. And in the case when you have norm to the power p, then you see indeed the damping here, closed loop, depending on x dot and gradient of f along the trajectory. Okay, so let me present some the precise setting, So again, we come back to our second order dynamics where phi is a convex damping potential. What is a convex damping potential? Phi is convex continuous, is non-negative, attains its minimum at zero, and the third property is this one. This quantity here is strictly less than plus infinity. So we have here the minimal section of the convex subdifferential must be bounded on bounded sets. This is the third hypothesis we ask for the function, for the damping function phi. Okay, if you are in finite dimensional spaces, then this last property is automatically fulfilled, since in this case the subdifferential is bounded on bounded sets. So don't be afraid about this last property. Okay, of course, the first question is about existence and uniqueness of the trajectory. This is not a trivial task, is indeed very involved to prove this. In the first part, we have a definition. What do we mean by a strong global solution? Namely, that x is c1, x dot is satisfies Lipschitz property, and x2 dot is almost is in L infinity, bounded almost everywhere on these intervals 0t. And the result is about the existence and uniqueness of the trajectory under these conditions. When f is a differentiable function, the gradient f is Lipschitz continuous on bounded sets, and it is bounded from below the function itself. And if phi is a damping potential. Okay, in order to prove this, you have to, so the proof is involved, you have to regularize the differential inclusion, because you start with a differential inclusion and you attach actually a differential equation by means of the Moreau envelope of the function phi. So phi is the potential and phi lambda is the Moreau envelope. The Moreau envelope has very good properties. It is convex and of class C11, so you can speak about its gradient. And if you consider this second order dynamics, which is written here in blue, then in the first part you prove existence and the unique existence of this second order dynamics. And then in the second part, written here in red, you have to use the theory of Bredis and Attouche about variational convergence in order to prove that the trajectory obtained here in blue x lambda converges uniformly to a solution of the differential inclusion we investigate. Okay, so this is a very brief how to do this. And okay, now let us get to the asymptotic analysis. So two questions: do we have convergence of the trajectories? Second question: do we have convergence rates? Now, without further geometric assumptions on the function f, there is no hope to answer these questions. So without convexity or without Loyalsevich property, you have interesting counterexamples in the literature. If you consider this damping functional, the quadratic one, so namely that we are speaking about the heavy ball method, then there is an example of a Touche-Godeau-Redon of a, you have a function which is C1, coercive gradient is Lipschitz continuous on bounded sets, and the trajectory does not converge. Yes, so we need to improve to impose further conditions on our function f. And here I have a remark on the bottom of the slide, namely, these questions are hard to solve even in the convex case. We will see this later. Okay, so preliminary results. Of course, we need a good energy estimate, a good Lyapunov functional, and we have these preliminary energy estimates. Namely, working with this energy, which is defined here, the function along the trajectory, and you involve also, and here is involved also the velocity. We are able to prove these integrability results. The velocity is bounded, then we have some integrability results. So depending on which properties you ask for the damping functional phi, you can further get some improved results here related to the velocity x dot and also x2 dot. Okay, and let me, the first case is the strongly convex case. In the strongly convex case, the message is the following: we get exponential convergence rate. This is the message, the exponential convergence rate. So if our function f is strongly convex, we have a unique minimizer, and we impose on the damping potential phi two further conditions: a local condition involving the gradient, involving this expression, and a global hypothesis, like here to be bounded from below by norm u to the power p. So under these assumptions, one is able to prove exponential convergence rate for all these quantities here: function, objective function along trajectories, trajectory itself, minus x bar, and velocity. The proof, okay, it is not, I mean, it is involved. You have to work with a good energy functional, and as a last step, you have to apply also the Gromov inequality. And of course, in order to do this, you have to use the strong convexity of the function, and it is technical. I will not go into the detail. Let me present also this case. We are still in the strongly convex case, but we are in the convex quadratic case with a positive definite operator A. So now if the function f has this form, 1 half axx, a is linear continuous, positive definite, self-adjoint. Then in red, here in red, you have the second order differential inclusion. What we get here is this ergodic convergence rate. Ergodic weak convergence, so weak ergodic convergence of the trajectory. What is different? Because previously I spoke about the trajectory and now I speak about ergodic result. Well, there is the difference is that in this result we do not ask for the function phi these properties, the local and global properties. Yes? So we do not ask this hypothesis. In this case you can get ergodic convergence result. The proof is also very interesting. Some ideas from Haro, Gendubi, and Basuira, Privat, and Treva. Okay, and let us take a numerical example. This is a numerical example for a strongly convex function. Yes, in one dimension, our function is strongly convex. This is the damping we consider. And in blue is the second order dynamics with closed loop control. So we have several cases. P equals 2. Then we are in the first case and we have exponential rate. And for P greater than 1, we have the ergodic convergence of the trajectory. But in order to pass to the trajectory, additional analysis is needed. So you have to do something more, but you will obtain these results. Okay, and now we have here some numerical illustration. And what is interesting here, the case P greater than 2, which is a weak damping effect. So if the values of P increase, yes, so if the value of P increases, then you will have more and more oscillations. Yes, so it is better to take P smaller. It is the first observation here. Second observation, if you are in the case when with the power P to between 1 and 2, and we call this strong damping, then you will have to take P closer to 2 in order to have better convergence behavior for the trajectory. And so this can be seen on this numerical and on this numerical illustration. But of course, this is only an example for this strongly convex function. This is what we observed here, that the power P has a great influence here on the behavior of the trajectory X. So this was the strongly convex case. Now let us pass to the convex case. let us consider again this second order dynamics with closed loop control, the damping in this form. What happens in the convex case? Now we will consider an example which is based on Haro and Gendubi. A function which is convex C1, which has coercivity property, yes, and we observed the following. If you consider the two cases, weak damping and strong damping, so weak damping, when P is greater or equal than 3, convergence fails. So in this case, the convergence of the trajectory fails for P greater or equal than 3. Now, interesting, in the strong damping case, so the power P is now between 2 and 3, convergence holds. And we have here numerical illustration for this function f in one dimension, which is defined here on the bottom of the slide. And we can see also here for the values of P greater than 3, we have indeed no convergence. And for the values of P between 2 and 3, the convergence holds. Yes, so this means that this limiting case with P greater than 2 is very important here in this context of closed loop control systems. Okay, so in the convex case, we have examples where the convergence may fail. What about non-convex setting? Functions with the Kurdi-Kaliasovic property. Well, here we have again positive answers. The Kurdi-Kaliasovic property has been mentioned several times during this optimization seminar. I recall this in this context of differentiable functions, but you have also generalizations to non-smooth functions. So this a function satisfies this scale property, the Kaliasovic property, if there exists reparametrization of the function values such that locally you have a sharp behavior of this parametrization. Okay, so this is the definition I took now from the literature. There are several other ways to define this Kaliasovic property. What I want to mention here is that this class of functions is very rich, is indeed rich. You have semi-algebraic functions, sub-analytic functions, tame functions, or functions defined in O-minimal structure. So you have a big, huge family of functions with this property. And what is important here in our analysis is the gradient, quasi-gradient system. These have been introduced by Begu, Bolt, Gendubi, and also investigated by Haro, Bartachil, Fanzoga, Cergui, and Huang. Quasi-gradient systems, why is this important in our context? We'll see on the next slide. So what is this about? Now we have a first order differential equation, and the governed by an operator F, capital F, which is locally Lipschitz continuous. Yes. And you want to approach the set of critical points. I mean the set of zeros, the set of zeros of this mapping capital F. If you're able to find a quasi-gradient structure for this differential equation, then this will be very useful. What do we mean by a quasi-gradient structure? So we say that we have here a quasi-gradient structure if we can find a differentiable function, capital E, satisfying these two properties, angle condition and rest point equivalence. So the second condition is to say that when finding critical points, set of zeros of F, you will end up with finding critical points of this differentiable function E. And this angle condition is similar to a phenomena which appears also in the analysis of gradient systems in the world of optimization methods. Yes. So this is about quasi-gradient system, quasi-gradient structure. And there is a very interesting result in the paper of Begu, Jérôme Bolt, and Gendubi. Namely, if for a first order differential equation governed by an operator F, locally Lipschitz operator F, if you have a quasi-gradient structure, then this trajectory you generate here will approach a zero of your mapping F, and you are able also to bound the trajectory Z, to bound this from above by this quantity where you use the quasi-gradient structure, so the function E you have from the definition of the quasi-gradient property. And what I forgot here to mention, we assume of course that E, the differentiable function E, has the Kurdi-Kaliasovic property. This is very important here. And now for our closed loop, for our second order closed loop control system, which appears here, we are able to prove the following result. Namely, if our function F is C2, so we need a C2 function F, and we define this E, this capital E A lambda, which is defined here in blue, and we assume that it satisfies the Kudikalia-Selix property. Then we need some properties for the damping potential phi, local and global properties. Then we can prove convergence of the trajectory to a critical point of our function f. Critical point now means gradient at this point is zero, so zeros of the gradients. Yes, so we are in the non-convex setting, but under the condition that we have the Kudikalia-Selix property. So combining Kudikalia-Selix property with quasi-gradient systems, we are able to prove this this result for second-order dynamics with closed-loop control damping. And let me just say, so in this theorem, we asked for the function E, the Loyasevich property. Well, how to guarantee the Loyasevich property for this expression here? This is a result we can use here, namely, if the function f itself is a desingularizing function for the for E lambda, then this will desingularize also this function E lambda. Yes. So asking properties for the function f, you can transfer down this property to the E lambda in order to have the Loyasevich property also for E lambda, and then to apply the theory of quasi-gradient systems. And you can get also rates. This is the last remark on these slides. Rates for this trajectory, for this quantity xt minus the critical point, the rates in terms of the Loyasevich exponent. So in the paper, we have considered also second-order systems with closed-loop control involving Hessian-driven damping. But here we are working in the convex setting. We need this also for the existence of trajectories. And since I want to pass to open problems, maybe 2 minutes I will spend on this. What are the open problems? So, and the challenges. So I started to speak about second order dynamics with viscous damping of the form alpha over t. Yes, so open loop strategies here. And we have these two important results in the literature, in Suboit-Kandes, but also in the papers of Atush and his co-authors. And this is the energy written here in blue, the energy which is used, the Lyapunov functional which is used in order to achieve these rates and in order to prove something about the convergence of the trajectories. So this is about open loop. What about closed loop? So closed loop strategy, if the damping depends on the velocity, like here in blue. Now we have seen what we have seen, that the case p equals 2 is a critical case separating the weak damping from the strong damping. Namely, the case p closer to 2 makes a big difference here. Yes, and this is still an open question, namely if we can obtain some rates, some fast optimization methods here in the closed loop control setting, by considering, for example, damping of this form, x dot. Yes. So this is still an open problem, and at this time we do not have an answer to this. We consider that this is still a very interesting result. Also, if we consider again the Lin-Jordan paper, where they consider closed loop, second order dynamical systems of closed loop control type, and there they obtain some rates. Okay, further open questions you can consider here: research directions, Tikhonov regularization means you add a term epsilon t x t in your dynamical system. Yes, there are several interesting results of Atush Kbani-Riahi, also both Laszlo and again Atush Laszlo on this topic. Tikhonov parametrization could be important if you want to obtain strong convergence, and namely strong convergence to the minimal norm solution. other questions or research directions could be, okay, so this one of this is the open loop, and of course the open question is to consider them in the closed loop control system. Other research directions, rescaling perturbations, errors, non-smooth optimization problems. For non-smooth optimization problems, you will have to work maybe with the Moreau envelope, so to regularize your function, or with the Yoshida regularization if you want to work with maximal monotone operators, and algorithmic consequences. Algorithmic consequences, I want to mention we have preliminary results in our paper, also on numerical schemes. So when you discretize such a closed loop control system, we have some numerical schemes we investigated in our paper, but this is only at the very beginning. And I have a literature. Our paper has been accepted in Journal of European Mathematical Society, and I lead here also other papers from the Tush and his quarters. Number four is Begu, Bolt, Gendubi on quasi-gradient systems. This was a very useful theory. Quasi-gradient system was a very useful theory in our context. And the last one, Lynn Jordan, which I mentioned also as a motivation for our paper. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Yeah, for your nice talk. Are there questions? Then,
maybe can I ask a question, Radu?
Okay. Yes, Constantine. Okay, please. Okay, I get. Yeah. Or who wants to start? Okay. Oh, Goji. Okay, Goji, go ahead.
So regarding this weak and strong damping, so how this name come from, I wonder.
Weak, I mean, okay, yeah. weak damping, meaning that you lose. So for, I mean, the property you want to have, for example, convergence of the trajectory, you will lose it when the power of P increases.
Uh-huh.
In this case, we talk about weak damping and strong damping. Where okay, so this is in this context when we interpret the influence of the of this power P on the damping. So I would say that this could be an explanation in this context on weak and strong.
Okay, so you have proven that. In this case, for P bigger than 2 and smaller than 3, you have convergence.
For this example here. Yes. Okay. So.
Yeah. Thanks.
Thank you, Roger. Constantine.
Yeah. Thank you, Radu. So my question is related to the Newton and Levenberg-Marquardt methods that you mentioned in the introduction. Can we actually use the dynamical systems approach to, for example, discretize the equation and obtain some second order method that would, for example, converge globally?
Could you please say again?
Yeah, so my question is, we have these differential equations and they have the Hessian, so I'm wondering if we can discretize the equation to obtain some discrete time second order method, ideally with global convergence.
Okay, so for example, related to this scheme, which is on this slide in red, for example, mm-hmm. for this one. Yes. So if you discretize, and then of course, then you will have like it is written here in red, for discretizing this Hessian fxt at x dot, discretizing in the numerical scheme, you will have this difference gradient fxk minus gradient fxk minus one, and there exist several papers on this subject, so on numerical methods, so algorithms in this context. which have this convergence rate property with 1/t² 1/k²
Can we actually discretize differently? Can we keep the hashing and just write xk minus 1 instead of x dot?
Okay, so to be in the very Newton case and to have it
Second order methods in the sense of the derivatives.
Okay. Well, in this case, well, of course, then you have to work with C2 functions, and to work also with the Hessian, and this could be much more involved. The analysis could be much more involved, and this was actually also here one of the ideas. So try to avoid the use of Hessian by discretizing in this way. Okay, so now if you want to consider like you're saying, and then work with the Hessian, then it could be that this is much more involved, and I don't know if there are some results related to fast optimization methods in this context.
Should ask Hedi, I think, since he yes. did the discretization of this system with Laszlo, I guess, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Eddie, do you think?
Do you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Yes. We had that's a natural, very interesting idea. You see, since you are close to Newton, Levenberg Marker method, try to use the idea of higher order system. So we had a paper. But for the first order evolution equation, not for the second order one. For the first order equation, okay, in a closed loop way, open and closed loop way, can you write the first order? Here it is, yes. For this equation, it's a paper with Zweiter and Marques Alves. From Brazil, we introduced it's a Newton-like method algorithm for which we obtained a very good result. But the problem is that in that case you have to make some restrictive assumption. You see.
And more restrictive than C2?
Okay, you have to assume that the deviation is positive, definite, something like that, you see? So that's quite a strong assumption, you see? By contrast, when you work with a second order system, things are simpler, you see? Because you can write with a second order system, things are simpler because this equation is a very particular structure. You see, it's in fact equivalent to a first order system in time and space because each term appears with its derivative. Here you have x dot and x dot dot. You have a gradient and its derivative. So the system has a very nice, it's simpler. You see, the second order evolution equation is even simpler than the first order one. Okay, but really the Newton equation, the higher order analysis, just like you mentioned, we did it only for the first order evolution equation, not for the second one. It's an open question. Interesting.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Are there other questions? Well then, yeah, I have a last comment. So it seems that in the case of systems with closed loop damping, there are at this moment more questions than positive results. Yeah? So there are, and this continues to be. So this was, let's say, a starting point, but it is obvious that there are still many questions to be addressed. I mean, we have, I guess, a good intuition also from the Lynn Jordan paper that one can expect, having a damping term which is vanishing, but this can vanish in different ways. That one can expect improved convergence rates, but so this we know to be the case for, let's say, alpha over t as the coefficient of x prime, so for Nesterov systems, supercontest. But there is a good intuition that this could happen also for closed loop damping systems in some situations, of course, depending on if one can reproduce this the same behavior. But there is, at this moment, no such result. All there is only an intuition.
Maybe. Hi, maybe. Yeah.
Okay. So now there are more comments. Yes.
Radu, can I have another question?
Okay, question. Yeah.
Yeah.
Radu, may I
ask? Okay. Hadi, so, you first.
Hadi, go.
Have just a question. Concerning Tikhonov regularization, can you go to the slide corresponding to Tikhonov?
Okay.
Yes.
Very interesting topic too. Right. Okay. Here, Tikhonov is written in a an open form, and at this moment we have no intuition of what may be the closed form of the Tikhonov regularization, isn't it?
Oh, okay. Maybe we have to change also that part. I mean, this was a quick writing of something. I mean, you refer now to the term with epsilon t xt.
Yes. Okay. My intuition is that there is a natural candidate for the closed loop form of Tikhonov, which is Ogasso method.
Okay.
You see, Ogasso method. It's something which is, you see, it's a very interesting direction of research, you see. But Ogasso method has been up to now only developed for first order evolution methods. Patrick Combet and Eckstein and many others, they use the Ogasso method, because with Ogasso method, you obtain exactly the same thing as Tikhonov. You obtain strong convergence to the minimal norm solution. Mm-hmm. Ogasso is a closed loop algorithm, okay?
Okay.
And so my intuition is that there is a close connection between Ogasso method and Tikhonov method, because both provide the same type of properties.
Okay.
But this is something to do.
Yes. I mean, what is Robert proposing here? He's proposing, an open loop regularization with epsilon txt, but that could be replaced by a closed loop regularization.
Yeah.
And then the question is how to find the right one.
Yeah. And if you are able to make the connection between Tikhonov and Ogasso, then maybe you are able to design an inertial version of Ogasso method.
Mm-hmm.
It would be very nice, you see, since you can revisit all these first order these first order algorithms in a closed loop way.
Mm-hmm.
Accelerate and for Ogasso method, it's not known. Acceleration is not known, see?
Yes. Great. Koji?
Yeah, thanks, Radu. I have a question, actually. For the synchronous acceleration algorithm, what's going to happen if this alpha getting larger and larger?
What happens? I mean,
when alpha increases.
What happens with the trajectory? As far as I remember, if alpha is larger and larger, then maybe it will not behave like you want to behave. So maybe it will be not so good for alpha very large, if I remember.
I'm not sure. I guess Hedy mentioned once that Fadili did some numerics and then just noticed that a large alpha is better than a small alpha. Is this correct?
No, actually. Yeah, actually, I observe this. If you discretize using the explicit owner, if okay. you choose alpha to be the step size, the 1/ the step size, then okay. this fall back to this second order dynamics fall back to the gradient descent somehow. But it in a continuous way, I think
okay.
maybe it's nice to have a understanding that when alpha goes to infinite, for instance, maybe this fallbacks to
yes,
okay, fallbacks so to the gradient, like gradient snow, that. Something like
okay.
So you mentioned the discretized case. So of course, when you discretize, you have also the step size, and this yeah. has an influence, of course, in the numerical experiments. In the continuous setting, I don't remember now for alpha greater than 3, but this is what I remember. I don't know, Hedy, do we have something in yes. the continuous case for alpha large?
Okay.
Yes, I have an answer. Indeed, it's a paper which is not still published, but on which I've been working recently, which is to understand the behavior of a trajectory when alpha is large. That's your question?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
In fact, if you do an ad hoc temporal reparametrization, then you observe, which is of form T maps to square of T. You see, you replace T by square root of T,
mm-hmm.
or by T square. It depends in what sense you make the change, you see? But you, mm-hmm. T gives square root of T, okay? Mm-hmm. And you consider X of square root of T. Then mm-hmm. when alpha is large, it looks like the steepest descent,
mm-hmm.
okay?
Mm-hmm.
Alpha large, you see, you make its singular perturbation theory, the solution looks like the solution of a continuous steepest descent.
Mm-hmm.
And since for a continuous steepest descent, the rate of convergence is 1/T,
mm-hmm.
with a time scaling, you observe that for alpha large, for the AVD system, you have 1/T square rate of convergence. I think it's a new way to understand why Nesterov method provides 1/T square. Because okay. with this time scaling, the trajectory of Nesterov look like the trajectory of a steepest descent. Steepest descent 1/T, time scaling gives 1/T square.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So, but from the theory, since we cannot tell that, because you always had for second order, you have this 1/T squared, which this alpha to getting bigger seems doesn't reflect it into this result.
Just an explanation why you have 1/T for the steepest descent and 1/T square for Nesterov.
Mm-hmm.
The explanation is that there are many explanations, but one simple explanation is that if you consider alpha as a parameter, and you, mm-hmm. you want to understand what happens when alpha is large, typically alpha greater than 3, you see?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but up to a parametrization T gives square root of T, the trajectory of Nesterov look like the trajectory of the steepest descent.
Mm-hmm.
That's the message. It's a very simple okay. message. You have two line explanation, and you understand why you pass from 1/T to 1/T square.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a time parameterization, T gives square root of T. Mm-hmm. Plus mathematics, since you have to do the singular perturbation theory on the second order differential equation, which is not trivial, you see? Not obvious.
Okay, thank you.
It's a new result, it's not still published.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Then I propose to stop here. Hmm? And I'd like to thank you, Robert.
Very nice
talk. To thank the participants also for a great discussion. So we will post the video in the slides on our website. I'd just like to announce that our next speaker will be Jingwei Liang from Shanghai Jiao Tong University next Monday, same time. I wish you a nice week. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Yeah, thank you, Radu. Nice to see you.